AT&T connects an ode to podcasts.
Connect the alarm, change the podcast you stream. Connect the snooze, 10 more minutes to dream. Connect the shower, lather up with the news, sports talk, comedians, or movie reviews. Connect with that 3-hour philosophy show. Change the drive into work and traffic so slow. Connect the dishes to voices that glow. Thank you to the geniuses of spoken audio.
Connect the stories, change your perspective. Connecting changes everything. AT&T.
This episode is brought to you by Kia's first 3-row all-electric SUV, the Kia EV9, with available all-wheel drive and seating for up to 7 adults, with a 0 to 60 speed that thrills you 1 minute, and available reclining lounge seats that unwind you the next. Visit kia.com/EV9 to learn more. Ask your Kia dealer for availability. No system, no matter how advanced, can compensate for all driver error and or driving conditions. Always drive safely.
I'm Mo Rocca, and I'm excited to announce season 4 of my podcast, Mobituaries. I've got a whole new bunch of stories to share with you about the most fascinating people and things who are no longer with us. From famous figures who died on the very same day, to the things I wish would die, like buffets. All that and much more. Listen to Mobituaries with Mo Rocca wherever you get your podcasts.
1, 2, 3, 4. Those are numbers, but you already knew that. If you want to know what number you're going to pay each month for your car, use Kelley Blue Book My Wallet on AutoTrader. They're really good at numbers. AutoTrader.
This episode is brought to you by Klaviyo, the platform that powers smarter digital relationships. With Klaviyo, you can activate all your customer data in real time, connect seamlessly with your customers across all channels, guide your marketing strategy with AI-powered insights, recommendations, and automated assistance, deliver experiences that feel individually designed at scale, and grow your business faster. Power smarter digital relationships with Klaviyo. Learn more at klaviyo.com/Spotify. That's klaviyo.com/Spotify.
So, is it March 1st?
No, it's still Black History Month.
I wish.
This game just went into overtime.
Let me tell you. Different movie than I remember.
How so?
Not as funny and entertaining as I remember it.
What?
I probably haven't seen it in 20, 25 years. I was stunned.
Oh, man.
Like 40 minutes in, I was just
you
like...
You were stunned.
Yeah, I was stunned.
I didn't know you could get stunned.
If I was a bodybuilder, I wouldn't be stunned. 40 minutes in, I was like, this movie's been on a while, and I don't know that I've laughed yet.
What?
Yeah.
Oh, no, no, no. Okay, now we got a Two Americas thing going on here.
What?
No, I thought you were going to say the movie does feel a little long, but to say 40 minutes in and you hadn't laughed? No, man. No, you lying now.
I'm lying?
You're lying. You're a liar. I think we've established that.
How does that make me a liar?
So which Two Americas are these? The laughing America and the non-laughing America?
Austrian America and regular America? What are you talking about?
Lying America. And
that's America.
America that tells the truth.
Yeah, that's just America.
No.
Ted Cruz just threw his daughters under the bus so he could go to Cancun.
What a G.
They got shamed into coming back. That's America.
Wait, he took a bus to Cancun?
Your picks have been horrible, man.
It's the point. It's the point of the show. Isn't it? Isn't it? It's possible. I don't understand what this podcast is about.
Poppycock. The fuck house.
On a weekly basis, we are consuming more concentrated bad movies than probably anybody in the history of mankind.
Poppycock.
What story? What story? What are you talking about?
Do you want lunch?
I have yet to laugh in this movie. I'll just tell you that.
You picked it, motherfuckers. Just remember that.
You know what the problem with Hollywood is? They make shit. Unbelievable, unremarkable shit.
So I was legitimately offended.
You were offended?
I was offended.
I didn't know you could get offended.
I was offended.
This did it.
If I were gay, I wouldn't be offended.
They're fucking making shit up, Amin!
Inconsequential detail after inconsequential detail after inconsequential detail.
Bees don't lie.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm holding a mic in my hands and now I'm talking all over. Okay.
Cinephobe, the podcast where we break down the movies you're afraid to admit you love. Zach Harper, Amin Al-Hassan, Anthony Mays. Patreon.com/countthedings, you dingbats. Subscribe. You get all of our great stereo content if you miss us on stereo. You're getting all the extra stuff like Cinefeud and all the holiday films. Patreon.com/countthedings. Tell a friend. Also, if you want to leave a review, review it. Give us a review on the old Apple Podcasts. Nice little show reference into the comments. Just something cool like that. You know, you guys have been great about that. We'd like more of that. If you have a submission for Cinephobe, submit it. But it's got to be 40% or lower on Rotten Tomatoes for the audience or critic score. March is Arnold month. We're kicking it off.
Arnold. March.
Arnold.
I left the opening for Amin to do an Arnold impersonation, and then he waited until I started talking again.
Wow.
It's amazing.
Get in the chopper. I was in the
this
chopper.
This week, to kick I off.
I was in the chawa singing yakety yak.
Oh, man, I got some, I'll say this, I got a note in there later. I got some real moose vibes out of Arnold in that scene. To kick off week one of March, Arnold Schwarzenegger month, 1988, crime comedy, Twins.
Ooh.
Buddy comedy.
Buddy comedy, absolutely. Buddy comedy. Definitely a buddy comedy. This is, oh my God.
IMDb has it as a crime comedy.
This movie should have been called Banter.
Banter.
The return of Banter.
Banter.
Back-to-back weeks of Banter.
Twin star. I think he made that noise on the floor when Kelly Preston was done with them. Twin stars Arnold Schwarzenegger and Danny DeVito. Arnold plays Julius Benedict. And he was in the middle of a run.
Oh, my God.
During the 80s.
He's the Running Man.
Predator and Running Man in 1987.
Running Man's a boring movie, by the way.
No, Running Man's great. Are you out of your
Running
mind?
Running Man's boring, bro. I tried.
File. Twins in Red Heat in 1988, and then Total Recall and Kindergarten Cop in 1990.
And then T2.
That run was sandwiched between Terminator and T2, Judgment Day.
Not to be confused with the ex-Terminator.
Which was starring that dude's name is. For DeVito, he plays Vincent Benedict. He had Tin Men and Throw Mama from the Train in 1987.
What a great movie.
Throw Mama from the Train?
Oh, yeah. Great movie.
Phenomenal movie. Phenomenal movie. War of the Roses in 1989. Twins also stars Kelly Preston, a repeat offender, third time.
Leverage.
Battlefield Earth and Gotti.
Leverage.
Oh, God. She was...
she's the wife in Gotti.
I forgot about Gotti.
Yes.
No.
Oh, my God. How do you forget about Gotti? Also, Chloe Webb.
For Gotti.
Who you may recognize as Monica Gallagher from Shameless. Bonnie Bartlett from St. Elsewhere. Marshall Bell from Starship Troopers and Total Recall. And he's a repeat offender. He was in Johnny B. Good. Trey Wilson, who was Skip in Bull Durham. And then David Caruso is back, baby, man, from Jade and
he's
Kiss of
back,
Death.
Baby.
I wish I knew how to quit you.
Between China Girl and King of New York.
Man, I can't wait till we get to his part because the way I discovered it, mwah.
Twins, directed by Ivan Reitman. Oh, my God.
Oh, this
Meatballs,
guy.
Stripes, Ghostbusters, Ghostbusters 2, Kindergarten Cop, Dave, Junior, 6 Days, 7 Nights, Evolution, My Super Ex-Girlfriend, and Draft Day.
This guy makes bangers. Also, I sense a trend of a slope downward.
Oh, he's all future cinephobes after Dave.
What are you talking about?
Dude.
Junior, Father's Day, 6 Days, 7 Nights, and Evolution are all eligible.
Oh my gosh. Evolution, I like.
Evolution's great. 6 Days, 7 Nights, not a great movie.
The Anne Hesh?
Yes. She Hessian?
Does that mean they arrived at night, by the way?
Yes.
I could never figure that out. Also, the whole get knocked down 7 times, get up 8. I don't get that either.
That means, well, if you didn't get up on the 8th time, you'd be just knocked down.
Oh, so I got up and then I got knocked down because I had to get up out of bed, right? Is that what that means? Okay. Now it makes sense.
That's how the song goes. I get knocked down. I never tip it down.
I would love a super cut from one of our fans.
Like a whiskey drink?
Of Amin trying to sing white music because he usually knows about 4 words and then just makes noise.
Noise? Noise.
Noise.
Who sings that song, I mean?
Chumbawamba.
There you go.
What's the song called?
Tub Thumping. Right?
Yes! Wow. He did it!
What an accomplishment.
White History Month is back, baby.
White History Month, baby. We're back, Mace.
Are we? Are we? Welcome to Cinephobe. Four writing credits on twins: William Davies, William Osborne, Timothy Harris, and Herschel Weingrod.
Two teams, but William Davies only seems to have really gotten successful when he dumped William Osborne and started making animated movies.
So Davies wrote Stop or My Mom Will Shoot. So did Osborne. Johnny English, How to Train Your Dragon, Johnny English Reborn, Puss in Boots, and Johnny English Strikes Again.
Let me tell you something.
And Flushed Away.
Puss in Boots.
Oh boy.
That might be the best. The best of all the Shrek movies. I said it.
What?
Puss in Boots? That shit was fire. Fire.
For Osborne, he did Stop or My Mom Will Shoot, and he wrote the screenplay for The Scorpion King.
Yeah, so that's two different directions after a breakup of Williams.
Harris and Weingrod. Trading Places, Brewster's Millions, My Stepmother's an Alien, Kindergarten Cop, Pure Luck, and Space Jam.
Mays, are you a Space Jam? Because you're of the age. Do you think Space Jam is a good movie?
I know that it's not now. At the time, I thought it was amazing.
Okay.
Why is that garnering silence? He just walked away.
Yeah, he asked a question and then didn't listen to the answer. He just walked to go make a drink.
No, he's listening. He's listening.
Okay.
But he walked away.
Synopsis for twins. I'll get halfway through this and he'll interrupt. A physically perfect but innocent man goes in search of his...
I was listening the whole time. I was hoping that Mays would go a little longer with his answer.
A physically perfect but innocent man goes in search of his long-lost twin brother, who is short, a womanizer, and a small-time crook. Tagline, only their mother can tell them apart.
Oh, no, the tagline should be, not even their mother can tell them apart. That would have been a much better tagline.
$15 million estimated budget. Grossed $111.9 million U.S., $216.6 million worldwide.
Banger.
Plus $200 million in the 80s.
That's crazy. Woo! And there's some great trivia about this.
Before we jump into this movie and the reviews, Twins is a rental, I believe. That's how I had to rent it.
It is.
Rental Wars.
Rental Wars.
Yes.
Bravo app didn't come through on this one.
Oh, sons Sadly. Of bitches. Twins inexplicably received 43% from critics on 42 reviews on Rotten Tomatoes and 39% from the audience on over 100,000 ratings.
Right on the line.
Amin, pause or neg?
What was the second one?
Negative reviews.
Oh, okay. I was just checking it really was White History Month. Full effect. Give me the positive reviews, Zach. I'm a glass half full kind of guy.
Well, everybody's just thinking about the negative. Well, I think the glass is half full. Everybody thinks it's half empty.
Brian D. Johnson of McLean's Magazine. Despite its contrived origins, Twin is a surprisingly sweet, gentle comedy that sustains its humor long after the novelty of the premise wears off.
I agree, because it is just all about the novelty of the premise.
What?
Like, this is the classic elevator pitch movie. Just Danny DeVito, Arnold Schwarzenegger, but they're twins. That's it.
Does chemistry... There's some great acting. I don't know, man.
Sky Staff of Sky Cinema. It doesn't take a genius to see how the caper might evolve with Arnie as the perfect specimen and Danny as the scheming lowlife, but everyone has fun turning the concept into a naughtier version of The Prince and the Pauper.
How's it naughtier? Also, The Prince and the Pauper look alike. That was the whole point of The Prince and the Pauper, is they look exactly alike.
Exactly. It's like the movie Dave, right? Dave is like Prince and the Pauper. That's what that is.
Yeah.
I don't know. I guess because he had sex. I guess that makes it naughtier. Also, I don't like the word naughty.
No?
No. Makes me uncomfortable.
You don't like when you're naughty? I've been naughty. Oh, you're a naughty boy. You never had that? Never been called a naughty boy? Naughty.
Joe Barry of Radio Times.
Nah, nutter.
Joe Barry Carroll?
Man, nutter naughty.
Now, nutter. Now, nutter.
Nobody said that naughty man, not a day you do. Joe Barry of Radio Times.
Joe Barry Carroll.
Here's one of those rare things.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Here's one of those rare things. A one joke comedy that actually works.
I don't like where this is going. These are the positives.
Richard Schickel of Time Magazine.
If I had a shickle for every...
The whole movie has a... When Amin just stops saying the joke, it also... Like, he just gets to the... He gets to the joke, but he doesn't finish it. That's a confusing thing for me.
Is it?
Isn't it?
Welcome to Cinephobe.
The whole movie has a warmth about it that never slops over into sentiment. There is much more here than tall guy, short guy jokes.
Thank you. Yes, there is. It was very sentimental, by the way.
Jay Boyar of Orlando Sentinel.
Related to Joy Behar?
But what's surprising is that Twins is somewhat sweeter than might have been expected. The mechanical plot may shake and grind unpleasantly, but gentler sounds also are produced.
Boy, are they.
Gene Siskel of Chicago Tribune.
I know him.
Schwarzenegger is amusing as a fish out of water in a land full of sharks.
Yeah, see?
He's a shark out of water in a land full of fish.
Oh, flipped it on him. Nigel Floyd.
The third rule of conflict.
Time out.
Of a crisis.
Crisis situation. DeVito displays his remarkable ability to shift from fast-talking cynicism to affecting sentiment, while Arnie reveals a reasonable talent for light comedy.
Wait, was this the first?
Yeah, this was it.
This was his first?
Technically, Hercules in New York might have been a comedy.
Yeah, technically not, but this was his first big movie where he's trying to be funny.
Roger Ebert of Chicago Sun-Times. It is an engaging entertainment with some big laughs and a sort of warm goofiness. Graham Young of Birmingham Mail. Here was a former Mr. Universe, by reputation one of the fittest men in the world, looking as if walking normally is surprisingly hard work. Perhaps he really was acting after all. And last one, Rita Kempley of Washington Post. There's enough sugary male bonding to warrant a sensitive guy's red alert.
A lot of these sound like they're describing a baked good.
Right. It's odd. Negative reviews.
At this point of time, my thought on critics not liking stuff is, then turn it off, you fucking weirdo. You have so many options. People who watch an entire project to hate on it, man, it is so weird to me.
Mike Massey of Gone with the Twins.
Oh, masshole.
Get out of here.
Masshole. I can already sense it.
Like many comedies attempting to exist in the real world, the numerous predicaments are far too severe to be approached with even a touch of sincerity.
Wait, Gone with the Twins wasn't the review?
No. That's the publication.
That was the website.
Is it a blog that's devoted to twin-based vehicles?
Oh, like what if they only analyze like the Lopez brothers and how their games are going?
Or Full House.
Oh, yeah.
The Sklar brothers.
Dave Kerr of Chicago Tribune.
I don't care.
For all of its geniality and gushing goodwill.
You're right. Well, go ahead. Sorry.
No. I left you room to make the joke, and then you wait until... Are you on a delay? What's happening?
No. It usually happens with Amin that, believe me, I look at the audio files. It's like I should move him up 3 seconds.
Just if you moved him up 2.5 seconds.
I am on a delay?
I don't know.
I don't think that it's a lag.
I don't either.
I think it's you. Like, you are the delay.
Oh. Well, let me just say right now. Wait, what was the
for all of its geniality?
No, start from the beginning. Start from the beginning. What was the guy's name?
Please leave it all in. Dave Kerr of Chicago Tribune.
Oh, that's what I was gonna say. You know how hard it must have been to review movies for a newspaper in Chicago in the '80s?
Yeah.
Siskel and Ebert are here. Who the fuck cares? Nobody cares. That's the answer.
Gone with the Twins is a movie review site by the Massey twins, but they don't comment at all in this review about how they're twins, and they don't just do twin movies.
They're not twinning.
Just one of them reviewed this movie, just Mike.
For all of its geniality and gushing goodwill, Ivan Reitman's Twins remains an advertising campaign in search of a movie. Peter Travers of People Magazine. What a concept.
He really had to traverse the...
Cast pumped up Arnold Schwarzenegger and pint-sized Danny DeVito.
Wasn't Trey Versus a podcast that Trey had about playing video games?
It was a Twitch show.
Had a cool logo.
Twins separated at birth. Funny, huh?
Uh-huh.
Sure is hilarious, even for about 5 minutes, but the 102 minutes remaining are a stretch for one joke.
Ah, oh, fuck you. Racist.
Jack Garner of... What?
March. It is March 1st.
Is there a single black person in this movie?
I don't believe so, no.
I don't think there is. Maybe in the background.
Arnold's got a hell of a tan, though.
Jack Garner of Gannett News Services. Maybe it's Gannett. There's a diamond at the core of this film, but you have to press down on a whole lot of coal to get to it.
Pressure!
I don't think that's how that works.
Film 4, Reitman has made a career peddling brain-dead schlock, but this tiresome gruel is even below his ground-level standards. Is schlock being mentioned in a review now part of Bingo?
First of all,
he's the right man for the job.
I've been listening to this podcast for a while, and I don't know why I went back to Ivan. I could have just kept talking. I don't know. What is the guy talking about? The guy made Ghostbusters and Stripes? What are you talking about? Schlock? I ought to slap you in the face with my schlock.
Philip Thomas of Empire Magazine. The film feels, rather than the solid comedy it is, like a massive missed opportunity.
I don't think they missed any opportunity here.
Yeah.
Where is he seeing the missed opportunities?
I don't know. Gregory Winecoff of New Times. This
red,
movie.
Red Winecroft.
Cough.
Arnold had never wanked off before this movie.
That's a good one.
Oh, that one was good. Oh, I see how it goes. It's March now.
March, motherfucker. This movie improves with depression.
What?
Whoa.
I don't know.
What are you going through?
Dark.
Janet Maslin of New York Times.
Do you guys ever get sad after you wank off?
I just get hungry.
No, you know what, Mace? I do, man. I do have a moment of, like, immediately after.
Oh, my God.
I mean, immediately after. Like,
what have I done?
What's wrong with me? What am I doing with my life? I get that feeling.
No, man, I know exactly what's wrong with me at all times. Yeah. You got to embrace that, I mean.
What are we embracing?
The regret.
Oh.
Twins is the sort of movie that seems to be made of styrofoam. It's instantly disposable, but it won't quickly disappear. Well, I think that's clever. I don't think it applies to this movie.
I don't even know how it would.
Ken Hankey of Mountain Express, Asheville, North Carolina.
That's what I Winecroft into. My Hankey.
Ivan Reitman is the modern king of comedy. Yeah, right.
Wow, man.
Not!
What are you guys Winecroft into, by the way? What is the receptacle in which you Winecroft? Because in the movies, they always have a box of Kleenex.
You should be using one of those wipes.
Oh, wet wipes?
Yeah.
Ooh, have you? Is that what you use?
I mean, sometimes.
I never thought about that. That's a pretty good...
Oh my God, are you kidding me? You got to clean it off anyway.
What do you use, Maze?
Kleenex.
Blanky.
No, I wouldn't get that dirty, Zach.
It's not yours.
Evidence.
I didn't say it was mine. I just said I wouldn't get it dirty.
DNA.
I don't know how I feel about Maze embracing it. It feels like evidence.
Now let me leave my calling card.
Oh, I'm uncomfortable. User Ted W. You got 1.5 out of 5 stars.
I didn't know you could get uncomfortable.
If I was a defense attorney, I'd be. User Ted W. 1.5 out of 5 stars. Terrible, horrible, cringe, pretty boring movie starring Arnold and Danny DeVito. It's your average cringe fest of an 80s movie that you'll forget about. For some reason, tons of people like this movie. I don't get it. The poster is cool, but man, the movie is bad. I can see that it made tons of money because everybody is talking about it, but man, I was hyped for this, and boy, was I wrong about this movie. Cringe, waste of time.
What is he cringing at?
I don't know.
This is what I hate when people use words and they don't know what they mean.
User Robert I, 2.5 out of 5 stars.
Aye, aye, aye.
Slightly better than Junior.
Ah, wow. No. No. Junior wasn't good.
Junior's really bad.
Junior was just like, you know, these guys had great chemistry. Let's see if we could do it again.
Run it back.
Money Train vibes?
A little bit, yeah.
User Harry W, 0.5 star out of 5 stars. This is the last one. Twins is good for nothing. All caps.
Wow.
Wow.
It has a childish premise, but it has criminal themes and vulgar language that is too inappropriate for children, as well as a plot that's beyond ridiculous and features people being murdered by gangsters. This PG-rated piece of crap makes Junior look like a masterpiece, and I was hoping maybe there'd be some kind of good in it. I was wrong. At least Junior had a good warm feeling and a good performance by Arnold Schwarzenegger. Twins had neither. It was the most inappropriate, unfunny waste of time I've ever seen in a PG film.
What an angry, angry PG movie watcher that person is, Ted W.
There's a lot of sentimentality in this movie. Like, I don't know what they're talking about.
To be clear, this man found a movie about a man getting pregnant way more appropriate.
All right, Amin, what's your first note?
The return of the FBI warning. You guys see that? You guys get that?
Oh, I do. I wasn't paying attention. I don't know.
Then I wrote, I used to think it was possible to have multiple sperm impregnate the same woman. Like, when this movie came out, I was thinking, like, yeah, why doesn't that happen more often? Now, mind you, I was young.
What?
G.I. Joe was really big at the time.
Huh? Where's this going?
Okay. All right.
And on G.I.
This
Joe.
This is a great first note.
They had a character named Serpentor. Serpentor was made out of the...
Yeah, I remember Serpentor.
It was all the DNA of all the greatest military leaders ever, like Genghis Khan and like...
Yeah.
And, you know, Napoleon. And I believe, don't quote me on this, I believe Hitler was in there too. Was in retrospect, wow, a little risque there, G.I. Joe.
Yeah.
I was just under the belief that, like, if you mix up a bunch of sperm and you impregnate a woman, like, the offspring will be, like, the genetic cocktail of all the sperm that was in it. I did not realize.
It's a hard CK on that.
Cocktail.
You did it.
We start off in a genetic research department.
Serpentor sounds like a really fucking weird guy.
I mean, he wasn't really. Like, because then they grew him artificially faster, right? Like, they accelerated his growth.
Oh, so he wasn't raised by Hitler. Just had his genetic material.
DNA, yeah.
Good. Raised by Hitler?
Come tell. Sit on daddy's lap.
Oh, God. Someone with an accent saying that on his 35th birthday, he decided to tell Julius the truth. And I wrote, this will be an accent that Amin does terribly, but thinks he nails.
Narrator exposition that never returns. That narrator just exists for that opening scene.
It's a cold open.
The coldest.
Julius was a part of a government experiment designed to produce a physically, mentally, and spiritually advanced human being. It's a top secret project. And I wrote, this also sounds like a very early to mid 20th century bitch German science project.
So Hitler is on the DNA list.
Also, did he put a beaker half full of semen out of the lab equipment?
Well, I think the glass is half full. Everybody thinks it's half empty.
Is that what that was?
No, not we're not doing this again.
Let me just say right now.
Settle down, Amin.
If the guy who filled out that rubber and how high thought he was doing some shit, wait till you see this beaker.
Also, six? That's more than six guys. Okay.
What?
That thing was full.
Oh.
He had six fathers. All very distinguished men chosen for genetic excellence. And I wrote, this feels racist coming out of February because they're all white.
They are all white, yep.
Oh, I guess it was a beaker filled with six men's semen.
This is very early to mid 20th century German.
Yes, it is.
They're all white.
Yes, it is.
And they are perfect. But that is a problem.
Heather Graham is the young Mary Ann Benedict.
Uncredited.
How old is Heather Graham?
I never knew that or registered until I watched this viewing of the movie.
Me neither, but it's just like, how old is she?
Like 17, 18.
All-timer.
Dude, but she's looked like that like her entire life.
Yeah, she's in Drugstore Cowboy the next year.
When was License to Drive?
Right before.
And then my next question, do you think these six men signed up thinking they'd get to have sex with Heather Graham?
They didn't?
Didn't they?
Welcome to Cinephobe? No, they didn't. They had sex with the beaker.
Well, I don't think they fucked the beaker. That's dangerous.
That's dangerous.
That's glass. You break that. What powerful thrust. Like, that's... Oh, boy. Oh, boy. I think those are the noises Arnold made on the floor of that hotel room. His mother died. He knew that from a very young age. He didn't know until he was 35 that he has a twin brother. The good kid in the shot has Arnold's name.
I have a brother?
The crying kid has DeVito's name. And this kid will not shut up. Twins is spelled with two I's in this, by the way. I didn't never notice that either.
Twins.
The Danny DeVito baby looks exactly like McLovin.
It does. That's a good call.
That's
a good call. That's the first one you got right. Danny kicked Arnold to make him cry, and now he's happy. This kid's terrible. Cut to present day, and Arnold's surprised he has a brother.
I have a brother.
Danny was sent to an orphanage in L.A. when Arnold was brought to the island. Arnold wants to leave the island to find him.
Strong double impact vibes.
Oh, big time. Oh, my God. And then my next note, Arnold is rafting off that island?
He is just gonna row a boat 27 miles to the nearest island, and he has that thing moving.
That's an inflatable raft. That's not a boat.
Gangster.
It's a rowboat.
Row raft.
Robocop.
Cut. Saints Row.
Row Parish.
Row Mama from the Train.
Semi-Row.
Rut-Row.
All right, cut to L.A. And Danny is sneaking out of a house roof, climbing down the column as the stunt man drops to the ground.
Oh,
then
man.
Running away as he uses an electric shaver. And the electric shavers, oh my God, awful memory of using those.
Really focusing on the neck beard on that.
Really focusing. He's almost always doing that at all times. And I remember how much it pulls, and it's just, oh, it's awful.
Never used one. Never used one.
Haven't used one in probably 14, 15 years.
Why'd you use it?
Lazy?
Don't say to shave. Like, why didn't, is that easier?
Don't say to shave.
It was laziness.
It's easier than razor?
Yes, because I could walk around and do it.
You can use it right after you sneak out of the married woman's house and do it on the go.
Exactly.
For a man about town.
If you lather up, then you gotta get it off, right?
Jesus Christ.
Baby.
Beakerful.
Oh, God, that's going to be a thing. He rolls up on Marnie and Linda. Marnie thought Linda broke up with Danny. They're sisters. He needs money from Linda. She's kind of got Ric Flair hair going here.
Even I was kind of turned off. I said, what a dog. He just got done smashing, and now he's about to holler at this girl? I thought that was much, man. That was a little much.
Really?
How often does Danny DeVito play a womanizer? Because obviously Always Sunny.
Yeah.
He's got a long career in that.
Strong Frank vibes, man, in this
movie. Oh my God. Big time Frank vibes the whole time. I was just like, oh, this is where he got the idea from. He's sweet talking her as a guy walks in looking for him. He hides and crawls away. Cut to Arnold on a plane with headphones in, singing Yakety Sax, Don't Talk Back.
Take out the papers and the trash, or you don't get no spending cash. If you don't scrap that kitchen floor, you ain't gonna rock and roll no more. Yakety yak, don't talk back. Da 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 da.
I knew you were trouble the second I laid eyes on you.
Excuse me. I just have never heard this kind of music before.
Flight attendant flirts with them, and then we get a Yakety Sax remix. The remix kind of fire.
Take out the papers. 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 Take out the papers and the trash.
Yakety Yak.
Don't talk back. Really, it's that don't.
Oh my God.
Arnold is wearing a blazer and shorts.
He's dressed like LeBron in the finals.
And he's respecting the boulevard.
Julius respecting the boulevard montage ensues.
Arnold loves to point out Stallone posters in his movies. Have you noticed that?
This is two for two.
That was a real rivalry. That's other trivia later on, but that's a real rivalry in the 80s. They hated each other.
But is that like him poking fun at him, or is that him like...
I think so.
A secret jealousy.
I think he probably looked at Stallone as like, you're a wimp. Like, you're not built, right?
Little girly man.
Because he flexes his muscle, right?
Yeah. He flexes his muscle like to like compare.
And then he like waves it off and laughs. Is mine as big as his?
Stallone's massive, right? Stallone is a massively built guy for a 5'6 man.
He's cut, but he's 5'6.
Stallone's a little guy.
I know, but I mean like, muscle wise,
he's the biggest 5'6" person.
Yeah, exactly. Like, he's massive, but to Arnold, that's nothing.
Yeah, Arnold's like 6'2", right?
Well, and Arnold's just bigger in terms of muscle. Like, he's way bigger than Stallone.
Yeah, Stallone was not Mr. Universe.
He's eating ice cream. He gives a plain hot dog to a homeless guy after taking a bite out of it. And he's just eating as much street food as he can get.
Pizza sandwich, drinking a Coke.
Homeless guy definitely gives the double take that homeless people give when you give them free food. And I'm like, look, I get it, man. It's not great to be homeless, but it's like, this shit always like really is bizarre to me. It was like, yeah, you want like my food? Like, ew, I'm not going to like, okay, so you have like standards. Got it, homeless guy.
Question, real homeless person or actor?
Actor.
It got to be an actor, right? There's no way.
Maze, that would be the worst. The worst. Yo, we wanted full authenticity, so we got real homeless people.
Right.
Brought all those craft services tables and shit. Like, no, you don't get to eat that. We want the authentic homeless experience here.
Yeah, we want you to be hungry.
I was thinking more you take an actor and you like rub dirt on him, and then he has to go stand like near like a real homeless person, and he gets the food.
Sees Man's Chinese Theater, which is playing Willow.
Yeah,
I got excited about that.
Shout out to my guy Warwick Davis.
Danny is right next to him. They just don't know each other. They scratch their ass the same way.
They're twins.
And then he's what? Then he sees the Rambo poster and
What was that? What was that noise that Mays just made?
Are they twins?
And twins. Parties that never end. Dogs that love cats. And twins. Danny pulls up to David Caruso's airport parking garage.
That's not a parking attendant booth. That's an exposition attendant booth.
Yo, I said, is that Caruso? And I began staring, but it was always above his shoulder, behind his back. And I'm like, maybe it's not. Maybe it's just some redhead. I didn't want to be like accused of kind of.
They all look the same, don't they?
They all look the same.
Yeah, yeah. I didn't want to do that. Yeah.
Danny is into the Klain brothers for $20K. David Caruso has a rose bicep tattoo. Did you guys notice that? That can't be the character. That's got to be a real life thing.
How do we not notice that in Kiss of Death when his shirt is off the entire time?
Yeah, he does have his shirt the whole fucking time.
Is this a temporary tattoo for this movie?
What a weird character decision.
Deep in character. I feel like his motivation was get tattoos.
Caruso's probably listened to a lot of Poison in his trailer.
Caruso gives him a BMW on the fourth floor, stall 20. He pops the lock, he peels out in reverse, whips it around, takes the BMW to some shady guy.
Tony.
Tony gives him 4K, usually 6K, but they're in a recession. Economics exposition.
Somehow, Danny DeVito's like going rate exceeds that of Nicolas Cage 12 years later. Gone in 60 seconds.
Market was flooded. I mean, are you kidding me? My next note, Arnold is horny. Oh my God. Still on the boulevard checking out displays.
Arnold is still respecting the boulevard, though.
He's got more buttons than Steve Harvey on that goddamn suit. I did not know, honest to God, I did not know suits came with that many buttons back in 1988, but he had like a good 9 or 10 buttons.
Stranger on the street is pumping him for questions, and a guy pulls up on a motorcycle, tries to rip the briefcase out of Arnold's hand, and he fails, falls off the bike onto the sidewalk, and Arnold checks him out. The pavement was his enemy.
I did nothing!
It seems, that's pretty good, that seems like an unnecessarily high investment, low reward style of Robin. They were gonna open it up and find like two t-shirts and a fucking pair of drawers. Like all of that, a motorcycle and two guys and all. It just seems like so much investment to get nothing in return. The ROI on that particular brand of theft is just low.
These guys don't respect the boulevard.
What's up, Cinephobiacs or Cinephobe listeners or whatever you want to call yourself. If you're a listener to Cinephobe, maybe you're just calling yourself a CTV fan. I don't know. That's not the point. We want to tell you about a fun new thing we're doing every Thursday on the Stereo app. Stereo app is a live social conversation app where you can be a co-host. You can be part of the conversation. You can just listen, whatever you want to do. But what you can do is support us and have fun with us and interact with us on the Stereo app. Every Thursday for Count the Dings, we're going to have Cinephobe content. We're going to have mailbag content. We're going to have after shows for the Cinephobe episode that just came out that week. You know, we put stuff out on Wednesday. Thursday night, boom, a Cinephobe after show. Talk about all the stuff that happened in the recording, all the stuff that maybe we couldn't say. You'll get an exclusive right there on the Stereo app. And it's easy. Just download the Stereo app and follow me at stereo.com/talkhoops. Follow Amin at stereo.com/Darth Amin. We're all on there and we're all going to have these fun interactive after shows. It's like a live show, but it's on the Stereo app. And the way you can really help us is when you go to stereo.com/talkhoops or stereo.com/Darth Amin, make sure we're the first show you listen to. Again, we're starting it this week, every Thursday. Download the app, download the Stereo app in whatever smartphone store you got, and come check us out as the first show you listen to Thursday night. You're going to help us out. You're going to be able to get some extra content, and we're going to have a lot of fun. It's a lot of interactive. Talk to us, ask questions, make fun of us, whatever. And we'll talk about how much we hate each other from that week's episode of Cinephobe. So make sure you hang out with us on stereo.com/talkhoops, stereo.com/Darth Amin. Follow all of us. Get notified every time we go live. Let's have some fun like it's a live show, baby. Danny can't sell high quality socks to a store, and as he returns to his car, he's got another parking ticket for $53. And I wrote 53 for a handicap zone. That seems low.
Handicap my ass.
Do I look normal to you?
Now the cop wants his driver's license. We find out he has over 200 outstanding parking tickets.
That's wild.
Arnold's at the orphanage. He knows the bed his brother slept in because it was close to the fire extinguisher and the alarm.
The nun is Happy Gilmore's grandma, Frances Bay.
Oh, that's right. I didn't even notice that.
What would you do if you discovered you had a long-lost twin? Would you try to track him down?
Wait, didn't we do a twin question before?
No.
We didn't talk about this on Double Impact?
Double Impact. No, it was something like, would I or allow my girl to like laugh at his jokes?
This is different. Would you look for your long-lost twin?
Yes.
Yeah.
You would.
Especially because I'd be impressed that my parents were elaborately lying to me this entire time.
Yeah, I'd have some questions, man.
If you found out your long-lost twin was in jail at that moment, would you bail him out?
Fuck no.
Not no questions asked. No. Like our guy Julius.
Contents of his file are missing. He disgraced things and stole money before running away. Nun says he's probably in jail, and it turns out he is.
He started the only fire in the history of the orphanage, and he banged his biology teacher, who was disgraced and had to leave the order.
I did not pick up on that until later in the movie. I didn't notice that.
I did.
Arnold, I bet you did. Arnold is the visitor for him. They're looking at each other through the glass. Arnold is talking without the phone, walks away. He has massive calves. Mavs.
Yeah.
Shout out to Chris Cody.
Is Vincent checking out his calves? Why do we get this calf shot? It felt like Johnny Drama and Entourage.
How could you not check them out? You see that?
Yeah, with the socks kind of rolled up.
I love the shorts. The shorts look was wild look.
Looks like a couple of pythons ate a softball. Are you kidding me?
Actually, a couple of pythons ate two softballs, Zach.
Well, they each ate one. You dummy.
No, but you said a couple of pythons ate a softball. That would indicate the two pythons are like nibbling on the same softball.
Why would they eat the same softball?
Because they're like sharing it. Because you said they ate a softball.
Pythons don't share.
Says who?
I'm sorry.
Says who?
Watch a nature documentary. Says every nature documentary. Ask, call Ron McGill right now.
You're trying to think of David Attenborough's name and you couldn't even think of it. He like says,
I was trying to think of Planet Earth. I kept saying Blue Earth in my mind. I was like, that's not it. Danny doesn't know what he's saying. It's heartfelt on Arnold's end, but silent on Danny's end. He shows him to use the phone.
You bozo.
When the guy says, that's Vincent right there, the look of surprise on Arnold's face is the same look that Ethan Strauss does when you're doing a podcast with him and you know what you're going to talk about and you bring up the point that he knows you're going to talk about, but then he feels the need to feign surprise.
Right.
That's the exact look. I was just like, holy shit, that's Ethan right there. The whole like, ooh, it's a little shiver of the head.
You mean bad acting?
Yeah.
Oh, the smile when he's walking back to the booth is just incredible. So many great expressions from Arnold in this movie.
When he sits down and he starts talking, I laugh so hard. And I forgot how funny that scene was. Because it's just like he sits down and he's going into like this full on story. And Danny DeVito is like pantomiming back, blah, blah, blah. Oh, blah, blah, blah. Like, I laughed. I don't know how you didn't laugh, Zach, but that shit was funny to me.
All right. Danny thinks it's Muscle from the Klein brothers. Arnold says they're brothers, twin brothers.
Oh, obviously. The moment I sat down, I thought I was looking into a mirror.
We are not identical twins.
Oh, no?
No.
Well, I wouldn't be too sure, pal.
Tells Arnold money talks and bullshit walks.
Oh, wait, my bad.
How can bullshit walk? That's slang, huh? Danny says pay money and he'll let him out.
I'll be anything you want. Your aunt, your uncle, your sister, your cousin, your brother-in-law, anything, all right?
And we get a throwback reference of, what is this, candid camera?
That was quite the reference there.
What is this, Impractical Jokers, 21st century, ma'am?
I love that show.
Arnold has more money. He'll be glad to help him. He loves him. Danny shows some homophobia when he talks about loving him and hugging him. And then he's up on the love talk or he'll be tossing his cookies.
They are in jail.
No, they're outside the jail.
Oh, it's outside the jail. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. My bad.
Hey, man, get the hell out of me, man.
He'll be tossing his cookies. More slang.
I had no idea that toss your cookies meant puke.
What did you think it was?
Did not know what that meant.
Mayes was like, tossing the cook. Okay.
Yeah, tossing usually means something else in the 21st century.
They find Danny's car. He won't let Arnold in. Drives off, leaving Arnold perplexed. And it's at this point I started wondering if I should be using Danny and Arnold or Vincent and Julius. And when do I switch? I wrote, will I switch it in my notes or just when I relay notes? Really started having a crisis with this.
Wow.
What have you decided?
Very meta. Note taking.
Keep listening to find out.
By Zach Harper.
How do you break the fourth wall in a podcast?
Another car pulls up to David Caruso, sends him to level four horribly.
It is Caruso.
My notes. Yeah.
He is horny for that Cadillac and nosy about other people's plans.
These are henchmen. They put a cassette tape in the car, get out, wipe off fingerprints.
Shout out to cassettes.
My next note, wait, they had key fobs back then? I guess I didn't know that.
It's not a fob. Well,
a clicker or whatever. You know what I mean.
Like alarm? You ask if they had car alarms back then?
A remote alarm, you jackass.
Zach, how do you think they set the alarms back then on the car?
I didn't know that they had alarms back then.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah. I was a six-year-old walking around checking out if they had alarms.
Doesn't seem like it because everybody's just stealing cars left and right.
Yeah.
20th century, bitch. I'll get on the program.
Danny's losing his furniture because he's 6 months behind on payments. Door says Vincent Benedict, sports agent, artist representative, import-export, automobile sales, rent leasing, wholesale patio furniture. He's a jack of all trades, boys.
He's a real art vandalay.
You're not going to ignore the taking back furniture, man. With the worst Jamaican accent ever.
Chet Hanks?
Why? I don't know. Yes, Chet Hanks.
Bumble clot.
He uses a driver on a basketball in his office. Al calls him, and he gives his secretary a few days off until they regroup. She gives him a birthday gift. It's Aqua Velva. I think that's the first aftershave I ever had was Aqua Velva.
That's the first aftershave everyone's ever had.
He kisses her on the mouth.
Misogyny.
Tells her goodbye and then throws it in the garbage. David Caruso says brand new caddy on level four and he'll be there.
Before he can get there.
Then a strong guy pushes him through the glass door, then throws him back outside of it.
It's another clean brother.
Punch to the gut. He felt it. Arnold shows up and pinches the guy on the neck. Thinks it can be resolved without resorting to violence.
And the first rule in a crisis situation. You negotiate first. And you attack last.
Well, you negotiate first and then you attack.
You never negotiated.
Nah.
You don't know what kind of an enemy I am.
Who are you?
Oh, I'm Vincent's brother.
We're twins.
That's right.
Question. Do you think someone who has trained all their life but never been in a real fight can actually fight? So Arnold has trained his entire life, 35 years, right. But he's never been in a real fight.
Yes, I think so.
His training with that guy looked pretty serious. On the island.
Yeah, like they weren't going through the motions. He was swinging on him. He tries to attack Arnold and he gets wrecked. Arnold's giving him tips on how to fight him. Guy grabs an axe.
Axe.
You have no respect for logic.
But he's got an axe.
I have no respect for those who have no respect for logic. You're a very stupid person.
He lifts the guy off the ground and throws him into an elevator.
Destroying.
And this guy is like 6'4", 260. Destroys. Like this guy's huge.
Destroys that elevator.
Yeah, the claims just keep getting bigger and bigger, and it's no problem for Arnold.
My next note, when did Arnold shower?
He hasn't. He's been walking around.
Need to shave, shower.
Arnold says, I hate violence. He says, but you're so good at it. Danny tells him they're not twins, they're not brothers, they're nothing.
He says, I don't think I can fight for money. And DeVito says, no problem. You do all the fighting, I keep all the money. And I wrote, banter.
Little Stugatz and everybody. Arnold guesses that he's got $20,000 in debt. Danny invites him to the car, and I wrote, his ponytail is upsetting. Really don't like it.
Really, John Clayton vibes.
But when it's out of the ponytail, it's worse.
When it's out of the ponytail, it is Frank Reynolds. 100%.
It is.
That's just Frank Reynolds.
They're going to grab a car from the airport to help out his friend Sammy. Arnold's reading the car manual to learn how to drive.
When he says, do you have a manual, the way DeVito looks at him, you didn't laugh the way he just turns and looks at him real slow, like, the fuck do you just say?
I smiled.
Come on, man. That's great acting. Man, that is great comedic acting right there.
DeVito's great, yeah. Danny lies to Arnold about Sammy not being able to leave the car keys. Car was supposed to be auctioned at a charity for kids.
Tells him no yodeling.
A lot of handicapped children are going to be very disappointed.
Danny breaks into the car, beginner's luck. Car alarm goes off. Arnold lifts the car so high that the alarm stops. Computer thinks the car's being towed and it shuts off when it goes past 45 degrees.
The car thinks it's being towed. Towed. The computer on the alarm.
Danny drives out. Arnold drives horribly behind him. Stop, go, stop, go. And then the face Arnold makes when he hits the gas is just fucking stunning.
He's so delighted.
Orgasmic.
He is coming. Like, he's filling his own beaker.
Not C-O-M-I-N-G. The other coming.
Danny calls the car phone. Arnold has no idea what's happening. Arnold pulls into the supermarket, hits the curb, goes two wheels through the parking lot, and eventually comes down as they park next to each other.
That was a little... That's when the 1980s took over.
No one likes a smart ass.
Linda and Marnie are smoking in the supermarket, which was wild to see.
20th century, bitch.
Yeah, very 20th century bitch vibes.
Arnold's got a Playboy magazine in the store. He's amazed.
The two women are searching, and they're trying to decide between different types of cake, angel's food or devil's food. They pick devil's food. I say, racist.
What?
Only because it's March.
Devil's food cake is racist?
Yeah, why is the dark cake devil and the light cake is angel?
Yeah, she went home and made a big black cake.
Damn right.
BBC.
Yo, she made a cake for her boo. I guess you could call it boo cake.
Because if you had a boyfriend like I have a boyfriend, you'd make him a cake like this and he'd love it and you'd get laid.
You'd get some boo cake too.
Misogyny!
There's no way Linda has trouble getting laid. Or Marnie. Marnie, I mean.
No, Kelly Preston in the 80s is...
Whoa.
A specimen.
Whoa. Enough with the objectification, guys.
Sorry, are we making you look good? Should we not?
It's my job.
We could be as misogynistic as possible. There we go. He runs into Marnie. He drops the Playboy magazine. He tells her he's from a tropical island. Just got here yesterday and found his brother.
300 miles south, southwest of Fiji.
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 Danny's standing behind her.
Twins.
He said it. Kelly says twins a lot.
Linda walks up and they make out, Marnie and Arnie. They drive off. Catch you later.
Arnold asks if they already know each other. He doesn't know how it works on the mainland.
Then Danny discovers that Arnold's a virgin. That's private.
Tells him she likes you. He says, me, but she hardly knows me. And he says, that's why women love a man who's mysterious. And I wrote, facts. Every time women have gotten to know me, ruin any chance I have at ever being like intertwined in any way. The only way I have is if I keep a distance, if I remain mysterious enough, that's the only chance I get.
Just don't say a whole lot. Maybe give a fake name.
By the time it's done, then they can't like turn back because then the Kavorka has taken over. Also, the line that happens is, I have the highest respect for women. Oh, you're a virgin. That's private.
He calls him a 230-pound virgin, which was an alternate title for this movie. And then I'm like, is Arnold only 230? Shouldn't he weigh more than that?
Only when he goes to the dentist.
What? Danny has a cat named Julius. Ah.
He also calls it a poodle.
They're microwaving food.
I like this.
Here on the mainland. We just nuke it. And I wrote, nuke it was such a big phrase back then.
Yeah. In the 80s?
Oh, my God. You
don't microwave shit. You nuke it.
The
nuclear age. Everyone was kind of, top of mind.
My parents will still say nuke it every time.
Very cool. By the way, do you guys pour your canned beverages into a glass? Because Danny DeVito is drinking beer, but he's pouring it into a glass and then drinking it out of the glass rather than just drinking straight out the Coors Light can. So will you pour that into a glass?
Very rarely, but occasionally.
Why? What?
I don't like drinking like soda out of a can all the time. Sometimes I'll want it like put some ice in a glass and then pour it in there.
Ice is understood. I'm saying it's already cold. It came out the fridge. Will you ever pour it into a glass?
No, I won't pour it into a glass unless I put ice in the glass.
Occasionally I will pour a beer into a glass.
Why? Why, Maze? Why do you do that?
Maybe if it's a frosted mug, maybe.
If it's like a nicer beer or if it's like a heavier beer, like an 11% or something like that, I'll put that in a glass just because.
To feel fancy?
I don't know. Class, I'm suffering from affluenza, something like that.
Going for the number 11 is big for you, isn't it?
11. Look, right across the board. 11, oh, 11,
and most
11.
Of the amps go up to 10.
Exactly.
Danny's drinking a beer. Arnold's drinking milk. I mean, how's your milk drinking going lately?
Yo, explosive. So, Maze, clip in the
West
bar.
Coast shit.
Exactly. I don't even know if they're a sponsor of this podcast, but we got Magic Spoon sent to the house. And so I wanted some Magic Spoon, but we didn't have any milk. We didn't have any almond milk, which is what I typically have been drinking for the last few years because milk upsets my stomach. So I said, you know what? One bowl isn't going to kill you. So I used the regular whole milk in the fridge and ate the bowl of cereal.
Do you pour your almond milk out of a beaker?
No, you can't mix those up.
They're very well labeled in my fridge. The milk made me have the most explosive, frequent shits I've had in a very long time. I'm talking about, you know, sometimes you take a dump and it's, you could just hear it being bad. It sounds like in the movies, when people take dumps in the movies, you're always like, this doesn't sound like that. Stop being extra just for the cheap laughs. That's what my dumps sound like. Like all whistles and spatters and all types of stuff. And I was just like, off of one bowl of cereal? I didn't even put that much. I was like, I want to just taste this flavor, see how good this one is. Oh my God, milk. Terrible.
Ooh, I like nuked food.
Through the lip, over the gums. Look out, stomach, here it comes. And Arnold eats psychotically. He eats psychotically.
He does. Also, DeVito's house.
Yo, nice.
What a great house.
In L.A.? Oh, my God. How is this guy struggling? Sell the house. You're a fucking millionaire.
They're in a recession, guys.
That's true.
Man shows up at the airport parking. Can't find the car that was left for him. He's furious.
He looks haggard, by the way, Marshall Bell.
Well, long flight, probably. One of their fathers was a famous football player. One was a physicist from MIT who won the Nobel Prize.
Oh, you mean the geniuses who contributed to the sperm milkshake?
Oof. Mom was like Superwoman, but didn't survive the delivery. Danny seems to be mocking the story. Arnold wants to find the fathers. Danny knocks every orphan's fantasy. I wrote easy, Maze. Danny has a note from public records that his mother didn't die during birth. They have an address. It's abandonment. Letter was 30 years ago. Arnold is amazed he had an address and never contacted her. And I wrote, Danny has some aggression towards her. Wants her to be in pain.
Well, why wouldn't he?
I mean, it's a fair point.
Yeah.
Arnold thinks she's Miss Perfect 1952, but Vincent calls her a slut.
That was aggressive. That was aggressive.
They do have six fathers.
He gets a call threatening him if he doesn't have their money. And then I wrote, I guess a cannon was just shot through the house window. What happened there?
Boy, those gunshots in the 80s.
Oh, my God.
Were those gunshots?
I mean, that shit
what
was...
What else would it be?
A cannon.
I don't know. It's one of those street weapons, the grenade?
Street weapons. The ones that Charlie Sheen did a report on?
Yeah.
Are you sure you're not a fucking cop?
Man from the airport shows up where the henchmen were. They were never supposed to meet. He's supposed to come there. Was supposed to drive the car to Texas. Car wasn't there. Merchandise was in the trunk. Instructions on the cassette. And he guns them down with a silencer because they saw his face.
In 20 years of service, no one has seen Webster's face.
I've always loved this in movies, is the sound a gun with a silencer makes.
Pew!
I love that sound.
Pew!
Doesn't sound like that.
Pew!
At all. Pew! Arnold ran to the address from the letter. It's a mansion. Kid calls for grandpa.
The sweat patches on this motherfucker. Jogging in his button up.
And that grandpa has Don King's worth of chest hair coming out of his tank top.
Oh, not only that, but also...
He is smuggling troll dolls. Oh, my God.
Who wears short shorts? Grandpa wears short shorts.
Arnold asks about Marianne Benedict. The old man is amazed. He's in the photo, and they do look similar. And I wrote, that's good casting, because they do look... Their faces are pretty close.
Pretty much. Nice bone structure.
Some would say elite bone structure, right? The purest of bone structure.
Yeah, the scientist we meet later.
Arnold calls him dad and gives him a sweaty hug. The man's shocked, offers him a drink.
Somehow, Arnold's sweaty hug is not as gross as the immense chest hair. Oh my God, it's so aggressive.
No, there's a dog in his tank top. No one has chest hair. That chest hair was like 3 inches away from his chest.
Oh my God. It had its own, like, life.
Yes. It's waving at people. Danny's driving the stolen car, finds a cassette, plays it. Instructions for Mr. Webster. Instructions on exchanging merchandise in the trunk for a briefcase.
With Beetroot McKinley.
You mean Tillman Fertitta?
Yes.
Well done. Old man asked Marianne to marry him. She turned him down. Told her the kids died at birth.
Big time exposition.
I call this scene Father Knows Expedition.
The guy who runs a lab in New Mexico told her, Arnold doesn't know what a dickhead is. And I wrote, but he is a virgin.
He's kind of a dickhead, if you know what I mean.
Dickhead? No, I don't. But I'm learning.
Danny calls the number from the cassette pretending to be Mr. Webster, and Tilmer Fertitta answers the phone. I wrote, the author of Shut Up in Business won't renegotiate. He wants 20 for his cut, and Tillman's pissed off. The deal's for $5.
What's the worst negotiation you guys have ever been in?
Sussman.
Keep going.
We're not going to top that.
Vincent calls him from a room surrounded by patio furniture.
Surrounded by patio furniture. 100%.
He's having trouble moving that right now.
He thinks the deal is for $5,000, but they're talking millions. And Danny's speechless. He's eating air as he processes $5 million.
The way he tries to contain his joy is so great, man. That's, again, great acting.
That's great acting. That is phenomenal, phenomenal acting. Yeah.
Oh, he is freaking out right here.
Acting his ass off.
$5 million! $5 million! $5 million! $5 million! $5 million! $5 million! $5 million!
Well, I mean, if you thought you were getting $5,000 and you're actually getting $5 million, whew, that's life-changing for some people.
Usually with Tillman Fertitta, it goes the other way.
But the best part is he crumples up the paper and does the Kareem skyhook into the trash. And I said, yo.
Oh, future callback.
Shout out to the 80s. Kareem skyhook is awesome. That was a thing that everyone just associated with basketball. Kareem skyhook.
He hangs up, starts freaking out over the $5 million, repeating it over and over. He'll see him in Houston. Fair is fair. He's loading up the car with clothes and potato chips. Arnold bumps into him, telling him about the man in New Mexico. Then he brings a sleeping bag.
Coca-Cola. He's going on a maze road trip there.
Well, he does a sleeping bag, Coca-Cola, map, and cookies are next. Danny tells Arnold he's going to Houston. We'll be gone a couple of days. Hey, New Mexico's on the way. Arnold gets in the car.
Road trip.
Danny agrees to take him, but Arnold's going to take a shower and get his bags.
Shower. Have a shave.
He runs in the house. Danny's about to leave anyway, and Marnie and Linda pull up in the driveway behind him. They've got a birthday cake for him. Decorated it like a fucking 5-year-old.
How many days is the birthday?
It's like Waz's birthday
week. I know, right? Exactly.
Arnold left the island on his 35th birthday. That's when he found out, right? We know it was nighttime when those guys tried to mug him. And then it was the next day when he goes and he bails out Danny DeVito. And then it was nighttime when they went to the supermarket. And so now it's today. This is day 3.
Yeah, he also rode 27 miles.
And took a flight and rode a bus.
From 300 miles south-southwest of Fiji.
This is easily like
Fiji.
4 or 5 days, right?
Oh, but we forgot about the time difference. Kelly made something for Julius, and Vincent hits her with an incredulous, "You baked?"
Yeah, she made cookies for him.
He says Julius is in the shower, and she goes in immediately.
Marnie made cookies for Julius. I guess I'm switching names now. Linda's mad. There's some fourth wall for you. Is that podcast exposition?
Yes.
We just invent that? Okay.
You just switch names like Michael Jordan in the 91 finals?
Linda's mad. He's going somewhere. Wouldn't say goodbye. Marnie walks in as Julius gets out of the shower singing Yaggity Sags.
Yaggity, yes!
And I wrote moose vibes in the house. She's checking him out in the mirror as he gets dressed.
Tension in the scene. Woo.
Yo, she's horny for him.
She is. From the beginning.
Vincent tells Linda about the merchandise. Neighbor comes over saying, never sleep with him or loan him money. And he says he cleaned her pipes once. Baby.
Agnes is a hater.
Yeah, man.
Never sleep with that man. Never loan him money and never believe a word he says.
Oh, woo. You just mad because he gave you the dick.
That's free advice. Morning, Agnes.
Give you free dick.
Kelly tells Arnold that she made him cookies. He says, I'm really looking forward to dosing them. That was terrible. Terrible accent.
Linda says she's coming with them. She threatens to scream to the neighborhood, and he agrees, but she can't tell Julius what's in the trunk. And then when Arnold gets in, Marnie looks unbelievable in the backseat.
No. Before that, he tells Linda he wants to look up our ancestors like it's Roots.
Like in Roots or something.
And I said, BHM, bitch. Still going. Your boy DeVito pulls out of the driveway like fucking Helen Hunt. Reckless as fuck. That's when Arnold gets in the car and Kelly is ready. Bro, she ready.
Oh my God.
If he had whooped it out right there, she was down to get to sucking and fucking.
What?
Immediately with a G in that shit.
Remember what Amin wanted this to be more family friendly? 3 weeks ago.
I mean, y'all didn't want to go along with it.
Yeah, taking out the swearing would solve that problem just like that.
Look, I tried. You guys were not receptive to the idea, so I just had to
look. Oh, you tried. You didn't even consider it for the next. You had no idea we were going to maybe do it for the next one.
You won.
I won.
What does that even mean?
He's not in it for the right reasons, you guys. He just doesn't want to swear for money.
Spring is just around the corner, and that means it's time to get that lawn of yours on track. I know. The last thing anyone needs is another complicated or toxic lawn product. But Sunday is more than a lawn product. It's a customized lawn plan that works with nature. They take all the guesswork out, and all the, more importantly, unwanted chemicals are out, so you can grow a beautiful lawn that's better for people, it's better for pets, and it's better for the planet. I'm getting it for my parents. They got a beautiful lawn up there in Oregon. Gonna make sure that it is safe for the dogs and it's safe for everybody and is the best that it can absolutely be. Sunday makes taking care of your lawn easier than ever. All you gotta do is go to getsunday.com. You put in your home address and their free lawn analysis tool will take care of the rest in just seconds. It uses soil and climate data to create a tailored nutrient plan so you get all the stuff your lawn needs and nothing that it doesn't. And it's using ingredients you can actually pronounce. Seaweed, iron, molasses. So you can grow better and feel better about it. It'll explain what you get and why you're getting it. Everything's sent straight to your door right when you need it. Let Sunday take the guesswork out of growing a greener, more beautiful lawn this spring. Visit getsunday.com/dings to get $20 off your custom lawn plan at checkout. That's $20 off your custom plan at getsunday.com/dings. Webster's in the booth of the parking garage. Caruso's tied up. He gives up Vince's address. Webster walks in the house. He grabs the cat. He sees the note for $5 million.
Trash position. Cat's position.
That's when the Klain brothers come in. The goons are looking for Vince. They want to know who Webster is.
When he's got the gun to Caruso's head, I said, tension. And then finally, the other Klain butter that walks in, the lead one, that's the dude from War Games. Mr. Potato Head. Mr. Potato Head.
He's one of the witnesses in My Cousin Vinny.
Yes, he is in My Cousin Vinny. That's right.
He shoots two of the guys in the feet, says your brother seemed to have a problem with their feet. Could be contagious. That's a good line.
It is a great line.
That's a good badass line.
I mean, it is his dictionary.
We get a Driving Through America montage. Then Julius accidentally ripped Vince's shirt.
Whoa.
No, he didn't just...
That is not an accident.
Yeah. He saw her thigh, and I wrote, he's never seen a thigh in his life. And to be honest with you, I saw that thigh. I felt like I'd never seen a thigh in my life either.
The innuendo of his bicep swelling killed me, man. I don't know.
Tore the shirt.
Born to be Bad is the t-shirt, his first t-shirt. They arrive in New Mexico and pull up to a motel. They drop the girls off to get rooms, and they go to the Institute.
Get one with a king-size bed. I wrote, DeVito trying to...
Yeah, he's not looking out for Arnold there.
At all.
Having a king-size bed, I could never go back.
I've slept in a queen-size bed after being in a king-size bed, and it's just... I feel like I roll over and I'm about to fall off. How do y'all do it? Your broke asses. Small ass bedrooms. That's why y'all got to get a queen size bed.
Who? Who are you talking to?
I'm talking to the people who don't have kings.
He's breaking the fourth wall of podcast. Oh, yeah. To all the poors who listen.
All the poors. Thanks for subscribing to the Patreon, you poors. Quote, Amin El Hassan.
Your tiny little beds.
Yeah, what the fuck?
You ain't getting no pussy.
I love the idea you're just talking shit to our great listeners for no reason.
I'm hungry.
Vince is nervous. Julius just wants the truth. Man denies knowing them, then threatens calling security.
Now he's lying.
Take it easy, Julius. He said he was gonna call security.
The first time in my life I'm pissed off.
He kicks the doors off the hinges. Oh my god.
Oh man,
what is this feeling? This feeling of anger.
Shows the photo to Dr. Traven. Dr. Trevin turns away security, says something rude to Vincent about escaping from a prison, turning out how he figured he would.
Security shows up, looks at a door that has clearly been knocked off its hinges, sees this huge 6'3", 230-pound dude with rippling muscles in clearly a death grip, and this motherfucker says, "Everything okay?" What?
He wasn't about to get that bluff called.
Yeah, I mean, you got a gun, don't you?
He's got two guns. Turns out he named the kids, takes them to the door from the opening scene, takes them into the lab. They weren't expecting Vincent.
This must be where you made the milkshake.
We weren't making milkshakes. We're making the most fully developed human the world has ever seen.
But instead of just one perfect kid, Mom had the two of us. Way to go, Mom.
Wrong. The embryo did split in two, but it didn't split equally. All the purity and strength went into Julius. All the crap that was left over went into what you see in the mirror every morning.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. You telling me I'm the crap?
No, this is not true,
well,
Vincent.
Wait a minute, Julius. I want to hear this. You telling me that I am the leftover crap, that I'm no good?
He's wrong.
Look at him.
Are you saying that a side effect?
You haven't got the brain power to understand this, and I haven't got the time. Show's over.
Holy shit, Doc!
Professor Exposition is being a real dick.
He is a dickhead.
Dickhead.
Father knows Exposition wasn't lying, huh?
Julius demands to know where their mother is. She's 2 hours north of Santa Fe. If you're lying to me, I'll be back. And I went, he said it!
He said it!
Vince is apoplectic. Julius walks him out. Vince says his life just got flushed down the toilet. Julius is trying to tell him everything's just the beginning. If they can find their mom, they can be a family.
All life taught you was all you could count on was yourself. And I said, message.
Also, this is where DeVito acts his ass off.
He acts his ass off.
Family, like with a Christmas tree and Thanksgiving dinner. And I thought he was going to flip it on him and just be like, fuck that. I don't want that. That's bullshit. That's suckers.
He wanted it.
He's like, real home where you'll always be welcome. Always. Even when you've been bad. And then they embrace.
Oh.
Danny tugging on the heartstrings, man.
Melted my frozen heart.
When Danny's talking about the Christmas situation, you could literally see like a fire burning in his eyes next to the tree.
Oh, my God, yeah. Oof. Shopping for suits. He's not going to introduce him to his mother looking like a goat herder from Albania. Is that racist?
I Googled that to see if that was a reference to Arnold or something, but I don't think his family was goat herders.
Yeah. No.
And he's from Austria.
I know he's from Austria, but still.
It was more of a Perfect Strangers reference, right? Balky Balkovich, whatever his name was.
What do you think that last name is?
Balky Balkovich.
Did you say Balky Balkovinus?
Balkovich.
I thought he said Balkovinus. Balky.
Barry McCockiner's original non-Anglicized name.
Balky Barthokimus. That's what it is.
Standing tall on the wings of my dreams.
Greatest opening song ever?
Oh, no.
Name a better one, you coward.
Simon and Simon, bro.
Oh, fuck out of here. Simon and Simon. Get out of here.
First of all, Simon and Simon is better.
He's going to pull it up again. Just wait. He's going to pull it up in like 3 minutes.
No, but actually, the greatest one of all time is clearly Good Times. Every time you got a baby. Good times, not getting hassled, not getting hustled. Keep her head above water. Something temporary layoff.
Good times. Jefferson's better than Good Times. Get out of here.
Easy credit ripoff. Good times. Scratching and surviving. Good times.
Hanging in a jar.
Good times. Ain't we lucky we got them? Dum, 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 dum. Good times.
The lyric is hanging in a chow line.
Is it hanging in a jiving? We'll never know.
They're matching suits. Need to work on the way Jules walks. Need to walk like you're moving to music. Aretha Franklin, Otis Redding, Wilson Pickett, couple of white people. I laughed at that.
I laughed very hard.
Is this your first laugh, Zach?
No, I think I laughed before that. That definitely got me. They put on matching sunglasses, take off the suit jacket, drape it over the shoulder. Do I look cool now? Mr. Ice. And I wrote Mr. Freeze origin story.
Future callback.
Yeah.
Callback.
Back at the motel, Vince is singing, "It's gonna be a good night, bro." Julius is nervous. Never been on a date before. Buy some drinks, dance with her. Julius has never danced before. No disco. Waltz when you want to romance a girl.
Strauss?
He dances with them to show him how. Hopes no one's looking in the window. He's grinding his teeth as he counts 1, 2, 3.
Movies never teach you how to dance correctly. Do not dance like they dance in the movies. That's my tip.
You're not wrestling a boar 300 miles south-southwest of Fiji.
Now they're at a country place dancing with the girls. Vince grabs Linda's ass. Jules grabs Marnie's ass.
Yo, first of all,
I wrote, Amin's going to comment on white people dancing.
I don't like when couples dance all over the fucking dance floor. Pick a 2 meter by 2 meter area or whatever and stick your ass there.
Meter?
Or what, 2 feet by 2 feet. I don't know, whatever.
We're in America, buddy.
Don't fucking be all over the dance floor as fucking Arnold is with Kelly Preston. They're just like bogarting the whole goddamn dance floor. Then second of all, the ass gripping is so aggressive. You gotta give it a gentle squeeze because it's all about increments.
Especially Arnold's too strong, man. There's no way.
Third of all,
you would have popped a cheek.
Zero cheeks in this scene. There was no risk because there are zero cheeks in this scene. Not on Kelly Preston, not on the sister.
My next note, do we think Jules hasn't jacked it before? Because he's so foreign to the idea of sex and dating. I don't think he's jacked it.
I'm guaranteeing he hasn't. Mace?
All theory, no practice. Story of my life.
Jules is drunk. They go to the bathroom. They do the same thing at the urinal.
They're drinking bottles of beer and pitchers of beer, which is quite the combination. Danny DeVito excuses himself by saying, my back teeth are floating. And I ask my white counterparts, what the fuck does that mean?
No idea.
I think it's supposed to be that you have so much urine in you that it's backed up to where now it's causing your teeth to float like debris in a lake or something like that.
That's literally grosser than just saying, I got to go take a piss.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to fight you on that. I agree. Vince says Marnie has the hots for Jules. Tonight is the night. The woman is ripe. And I wrote ripe is uncomfortable. I don't like that.
I don't know. Also, have you guys ever had a girl like you, but you didn't know it? Like when they're telling you, yo, she likes you, like, word?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
How'd you handle it?
Fucked her.
Oh, good job.
Wait! Vince lost his virginity at 12 years old to a nun?
Talk about pressure.
That's dark.
I mean, actually, no pressure. Because she hasn't fucked either. She doesn't know if you're trash or not.
No, but he's competing with God.
She's raping a child for her first time.
Look, hey.
What?
I mean, I don't have any.
All right. Vince says since they met, his life is better and better.
Touching, man.
Plain brothers show up to this place.
The Native American that walks into the bathroom is Steve Rivas, a.k.a. Shep Proudfoot from Fargo, the movie.
Oh, how about that?
Wow.
I didn't notice
that. How about that?
Some amazing sleuthing by the Klein brothers.
Oh, yeah, they're great.
Yeah, can we talk about this? So the sisters get fired from their jobs, but somehow told their boss what bar in New Mexico to find them at, but not the hotel. Because they're safe at the hotel later?
Yeah, I mean, I guess there's just, you got to suspend.
Oh, yeah. I mean, this movie's all about suspended disbelief. Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger are twins.
They sit down with Marnie and Linda. The Klein brothers want to kill Vince in the parking lot. They pull guns on the girls.
You move too soon.
What?
The second rule in a crisis situation.
Uh-oh. He's starting that funny talk again.
If you choose to bluff, you must be prepared to have your bluff called.
When they grab him by his arms, and then he ends up high-kicking both of the Klein brothers, he does this crazy war cry.
Oh, my God. Yeah! Oh, my God.
I was like, hey, yo, I would have quit right there.
Kicks the guys in the booth, knocks out the other cousins by slamming them together. Vince hits the other guy, then grabs a guitar, smashes it on him, and I wrote, if I'm in the band, I'm furious. You couldn't grab a chair and hit this dude? You gotta break my guitar?
Yeah, that's Jeff Beck. He's probably pissed.
I was pissed.
I love when you hit people.
Then people are dancing around the knocked out guy. Jules is getting ready to sleep on the floor. Vince is getting ready to go to Linda's room. Marnie knocks on the door. Has to stay in there tonight. She's trying to bang.
She ready?
Julius cannot take a hint.
Kisses him, goes into the bed as he gets on the floor. She's being very suggestive.
Puts a pill on his head because he's a little kid. Doesn't know how to react in these situations. Much like Mays.
Oh, boy.
She knows how to react in these situations.
She says the bed's lumpy, gets on the floor with them. He finally recognizes that she's teasing him. They bang.
Need to try this sometime. Pretending like you don't know how to have sex. I know we've done this topic before, but
oh my God. Just
thought I'd bring it back. This is my first time.
Vince is doing sit-ups and push-ups. Linda wants to move in together. He says no. She doesn't want to get married or keep track of him.
No, 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 no. He doesn't say no. He says no like fucking Liam Neeson. No, 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 no.
No, 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 no. That's too far.
I'm cranky in the morning. I'm grouchy in the afternoon. I'm moody at night. I'm like miserable.
There's a listener who said that Mayes sounds like Snarf from fucking He-Man when he talks like that. And I have to agree. You do sound like Snarf.
Snarf.
He says she's the only girl. Marty's smoking on the floor, and Jules just looks like an idiot.
Yo, this frozen O face.
Oh my God.
On Arnold's face. I sent it to the chat earlier. Oh, iconic.
That's how I look after sex.
Just paralyzed. Mr. Ice.
Have you guys ever smoked after sex?
No.
Sure looks cool, doesn't it?
It does. I want to kind of do it.
Could you get away with that today?
Smoking indoors is just a super slippery slope.
What about on a playground?
Mace?
No, you got to get the fuck out of there. You don't have time to chill and enjoy it.
I don't like him leaning into it. I don't like this. They show up to a huge estate. Guy at the gate says it's not possible to see Marianne, whatever the fuck her name is.
Benedict, motherfucker.
Yeah, Benedict.
The Benedict Foundation. Vincent starts freaking out about how rich they are. Millions! Buckaroos!
Millions. They need to write a letter to the foundation stating their business. They sneak in. Woman asks if they should be there. They say they're Marianne's twin sons. She says to follow her. We get some Marianne exposition about buying into Whispering Pines.
Exposition.
Says that she passed away some time ago. Her spirit is always there. She leads them to the front gate. They drive off. We find out the guide was Marianne.
Aha!
And she thought they were real estate developers. She thinks her child died at birth. Vince is now taking out on Linda and Jules. Says that she's there for the money.
Calls Julius the creature from the Black Lagoon.
Yeah, there's a throwback. Family, my butt. He takes the stuff out of the car, drives off. That's a dick move, man. He left him in the middle of nowhere.
It is a dick move, but I just want to point out, we see Julius's suitcase, and we see like two shopping bags.
Yep.
And that's it. That's all the luggage.
Yeah.
Yeah, they must have eaten the cake.
Linda tells Jules about the thing in the trunk and the delivery, and she's worried he'll get himself killed. That's when Vincent calls Tillman for Tita, says he'll be there in the morning. But Mr. Webster is in Tillman's office. He'll be doing business with Vincent. Webster's playing nice, and Jules is getting on a small plane to go find Vincent as he abandons the girls.
But how will you find him? I have him in my head. Does Arnold still think he's the Terminator?
My next notes. Clip it, Mays. Clip it, Mays. Clip it, Mays. Brother to brother plays. One to another like no other. Brother to brother. Brother to brother. Never knew you existed. Never saw you in my dreams. Oh, my God. Clip it. What a fucking song.
Brother to brother.
The banger, man.
My next note, Julius steals old Tex's car.
Getting the Houston montage, twin synergy montage, and he steals Tex's car. Johnny be good.
Same car.
Now, let me just say this right now. Oh, man. Did I say this already? Shit.
Oh, God.
Convertibles with horns. That was a thing.
Was it?
Like in every TV show, every movie, how do you know you're in Texas? A caddy convertible with horns on it. That was a thing, and I fear that today's like Gen Z's and all these people, they don't know about that shit. They have no idea.
You fear that?
I fear it.
All right, Jules takes the car. I wrote this song, bangs. Vincent pulls up in the car. They pull guns on him. Check out the merchandise.
Pre-GPS life was awful.
Oh, God, here we go.
I'm just saying.
Pre-MapQuest, too.
He's out here with like a real fucking map.
20th century, bitch.
They realize he's just some fool who stole a car. It's a revolutionary fuel injection system for jets. Worth a fortune, the company that brings it to market.
Strong monologuing from Tillman Fertitta here.
Shut up in business.
Tillman Fertitta's bodyguard is Troy Aikman, by the way.
That's a good call. Thinks they're about to kill him, but they give him the briefcase with the money, and they drive away. That's when Vincent hears gunshots, and the car crashes. Webster shot them. He's looking for a gunman. Runs out into the open for some reason. Webster misses him.
Yeah, he decides to run for it.
Oh my god. Terrible decision.
I mean, not great.
Why do you say is it not a good decision? He got away.
No, I played Russian roulette and didn't die. That doesn't mean it was a good decision.
Hey.
He's honestly screwed anyways, because he gets stranded in the middle of nowhere with a suitcase full of money. Like, you know, he's got to walk back to wherever he's planning to go. It's not a good plan.
So, Maze, you wouldn't do that?
I probably wouldn't have ditched my twin brother and two people in the middle of nowhere so I could have had some backup. Yeah, I wouldn't have done that.
I might have grabbed a handful of cash and thrown it around. Just to see if he would stop and pick some of it up.
I would have asked, okay, you guys got here somehow. Why do both of y'all get in this car, drive away? Where's the other car?
That's a good question.
Mm.
Jules pulls up. Vince escapes down some stairs into a tunnel with a lot of pipe work at the aerospace company.
That was the first time I could not suspend my disbelief in this entire movie. That right there, I was like, they showed up in a car.
Where could it be? Webster finds him and shoots at him. As he's about to pull the trigger, Jules throws his briefcase at him and knocks the shooting offline. Leave my brother alone. Vince hears him, starts to run away, but then turns back.
Don't be nervous. I hate violence. Plus, I never carry a gun.
He doesn't hear him. He feels him.
Oh, he feels him?
Yeah, this is the twin sense shit.
Yeah.
Well, I thought he heard him at first and ran away anyway and then felt him and just decided to turn around.
No, he felt him.
I bet he did. He brings Webster the money and says to put the gun down.
What the fuck? Incest, Zach? Is that going to be your lane?
Incest position. Says, you, I'm never going to forgive. Makes him open the briefcase with all the money. Jules says he was trying to distract so Vince could escape, and he was halfway to Brazil when I felt you. I said, tension?
Halfway to Brazil when I felt you means something very different these days.
He didn't go because he's a psychic, thanks to Jules. He has a disease called a conscience. Webster says to shut up.
This is all banter right here.
Wait a minute. He forgot the rule, the third rule in a crisis situation. The third rule? Knock. He releases a chain that knocks him out. It is cartoonishly long, and he is now buried alive.
That man is dead.
There's a shot where we see that Webster is directly under something on a chain, and the twins are next to a lever. Yada, yada. It happens. This chain falls for 30 solid seconds.
Yeah.
This is what happens when Jared Leto and 2 Chainz do a song together. 30 seconds of chains. Holy schmoly.
Don't laugh at that.
I wrote that
overly contrived joke.
When someone has to go clean that up, will they be expecting a dead body in there?
Absolutely not.
The pile is so comically large. Like, this was such a departure from the rest of the movie.
From the realism.
Was it really? The one where Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger are twins?
The one where the guys show up in a car and then they drive off in a different car, but the other car isn't there anymore, Maze?
I wanted more of this. I wanted more of 30 seconds of chains.
We're brothers, right? We're family. A rich family. Jules says they got to give the money back. Now they're on the front page at USA Today for returning the stolen engine.
By the way, you forgot the action movie money line. Now there is a man with a lot on his mind.
You think that's where Caruso got it from for CSI Miami?
Yeah!
Fainter shows it to Marianne. She knocks out the shitbag scientist.
Nice right hook.
Vincent's trying to make up with Linda. She won't give it to him. Her apartment is full of flowers. I wrote, that's going to be really bad to clean up. That was a lot of flowers.
Somehow he snuck around inside the apartment and is walking on his knees, and already diminutive Danny DeVito made himself shorter.
He's a goddamn illusionist. How did he get in there? That's an apartment. Benedict Corporation has them both working at a double desk. After the $50,000 reward, they have $12,278 left. But then Vincent says that $4 million they gave back, right? We know it was $5. He kept $1 million. And I wrote, there is some aggressive tax fraud in his future. Shout out to that shitbag, Brian Sussman.
Feels great to be a good guy.
Marianne walks in the office without them noticing. She's holding a teddy bear. One teddy bear for 2 children, huh? Terrible mom.
Kind of like those 2 pythons that had to share the one softball.
You found each other. Now you found me. That is the worst fucking writing.
It's terrible.
For the end of a movie.
They lied to her and them all these years.
Mama. Mama. Mama.
Oh, mama.
Then everyone's at an amusement park or something. They're pushing twin strollers. They're going to take a family picture with the 4 kids.
Twins had twins.
80s music plays, roll credits, and again, twin song.
This song. We're united, outside and in.
was a terrible ending. Great movie.
They're kind of up in the air with that one.
Terrible ending.
No, that was Jason Reitman's movie, Amin.
But I got emotional nonetheless.
Oh, it's terrible. No.
Got emotional several times in this movie.
You okay?
I didn't know you could get emotional.
I got emotional.
This did it!
If I wasn't a misogynist, I wouldn't be emotional. Trivia. Arnold said that this film was the best decision he ever made.
Okay, so that is in relation to the fact that instead of taking their usual salaries, Schwarzenegger and DeVito both agreed to take 20% of the film's box office.
Oh my God.
Resulting in the biggest paychecks of their careers. Ivan Reitman also got a cut of the box office.
Good for them.
So they made $260 million, 20% of that. You can do the math.
$52 million.
It is indubitably one of the best decisions he ever made.
I thought he just meant in terms of pivoting his career.
That's part of it, but man.
They made the deal on a napkin at lunch with the agents, signed it, and then DeVito had the napkin framed.
I bet he did. And that's why he's a big Hollywood producer. Producing movies like How High.
Oh, that's right. He did do How High.
And
Austin Powers.
More trivia, Pulp Fiction, which also has characters named Jules and Vincent.
Oh, wow. Is that to commemorate it being rich as fuck in that movie?
In commemoration of being rich as fuck, Quentin Tarantino, please name these characters Jules and Vincent.
Arnold always wanted to do a sequel called Triplets with Danny DeVito and adding Eddie Murphy as a long-lost third brother. DeVito pitched script ideas back in 2003, but Arnold was too busy running for governor of California.
California.
DeVito agreed with his decision, but doubted he would become governor. Then in 2012, at the end of the governorship.
I'm the governor of California.
Plans for the sequel were officially confirmed, although as of 2019, it's still in pre-production.
In April 2015, it was announced the plans for the film were put on hold. In March 2018, Schwarzenegger confirmed the script was finished and that Murphy was officially attached.
Eddie Murphy is attached. The script is finished.
Schwarzenegger briefly discussed how Murphy's character became the brother of his and DeVito's characters, saying, "Funny thing happens in the mixing of the sperm."
A funny thing happens in the mixing of the sperm.
Sperm. The mixing of the sperm.
Sperm.
So yeah, they've been talking about this for 20 years and
yeah.
I don't think we're any closer to it actually happening. But Triplets?
This blew my mind. Arnold Schwarzenegger, Danny DeVito, and Hulk Hogan all revealed in interviews that Schwarzenegger and DeVito were given the option of doing Twins or Suburban Commando. Had they chosen to do Suburban Commando, Hulk Hogan and Christopher Lloyd would have done this movie.
Oh my God.
Have you seen Suburban Commando?
I have not, but I want to see Twins with Hulk Hogan and Christopher Lloyd.
Yo, Suburban Commando's got to qualify, right?
Yeah, it just sounds like it does.
Yes, 15%.
As a child who was into wrestling, I was all about Suburban Commando. It's an awful movie. The original title was The Experiment, but it was dropped because of Arnold Schwarzenegger's Germanic background. How about that?
Oh, boy.
During production, the title was briefly changed to Brothers to avoid confusion with David Cronenberg's Dead Ringers, which was at that time also called Twins. Two real-life twins were reunited with their father after seeing him in the scene set in downtown Santa Fe. I have no idea if that's true or not, but that's
There's no funny. Way that's true. There's no way.
Arnold Schwarzenegger did not pick up the car in reality. Sorry to bust the bubble on that.
Damn.
And then I like this one. The second film released in 1988 to feature a male character teaching their brother how to slow dance with a woman in a hotel room after being recently reunited, the other being Rain Man,
which
would premiere exactly a week later.
Woo! Imagine seeing Twins and then a week later going to see Rain Man and say, what's going on?
Is it a volcano Dante's Peak situation? Deep Impact and Armageddon? Yeah.
Well, I mainly eat out of a dumpster.
I should try that. I need some new dresses.
Don't. Or if you do, stay away from the one at Ocean in Wilshire. That's mine. Seriously. Stay out of it.
Golden Dumpster nominees. Julius's sheer delight at every mundane thing. Julius's shorts. Julius's slang vocabulary. Bullshit walks. Toss cookies. Dickhead.
Dickhead.
Back teeth are floating. Agnes, Vincent's nosy neighbor with the dirty pipes.
Baby.
Arnold's bicep growing when he gets horny. Julius getting pissed off for the first time in his life. Julius's O-face. Banter. Danny DeVito acting his ass off talking about growing up with Christmas. And the absurd pile of chains that buries Webster at the end.
I gotta go with the O-face.
Yeah, I mean, that.
I gotta stay on brand here.
I think it's the O face for me, too.
Oh, man.
You sent it to the chat. Sweep it, you fucking coward.
I'll sweep it, but I just have to say, the chains, I wanted more of that in this movie, but I will sweep Arnold's frozen O face.
Do the chain hang low? Do the body find the flow? Do the song? Is it by the musical?
I guess it's not just white music, just music in general.
Do the chain hang low? What movie did we watch that had that as the opening scene?
Oh.
Didn't we have it? Watch it? Oh, it was Drill Bit Taylor.
Yeah. All right. Amin, you picked it, motherfucker. Flober file.
This is a strong file for me. It, much like How High. Not quite as great as I remember it, probably because the pacing was a little slow, but I love the on-screen chemistry between Arnold and DeVito. I thought they both acted their asses off. I thought for a guy who doesn't get emotional watching movies, there were several moments in this movie where I legit got emotional. I was like, oh man, I really felt this. This is a great movie. Again, I'm still staggered that it qualifies, that people at the time did not like this movie, because all I remember it was... It was a rousing success.
I'm shocked that the audience is why it qualifies. I could get critics deciding, no, this is contrived or whatever. Like, I could understand the reaction. I wouldn't agree. But the audience not liking it, that's shocking to me.
Shocking.
Shocking. It's definitely not as good as I remembered it. For me, I thought it was hilarious as a kid because it's the novelty of DeVito next to Arnold. 32 years in between that realization. That part doesn't really do it for me, but DeVito is acting his ass off in this movie. He's fantastic. Arnold's really good, for especially for a first time in a comedic role. It's a file for me. It's not nearly as funny as I thought it was, but it's a good movie. Like, legitimately good movie.
I disagree that it's a good movie. I think it's a elevator pitch premise that is very cookie cutter constructed together. Like, 45 minutes in, they're just like, oh, we're going to make this a road trip movie, and we're going to go to New Mexico and Texas and visit Tillman Fertitta. But Danny DeVito is in his bag. He's doing Danny DeVito, Frank Reynolds things. He gets away with so much as just being kind of absurd looking and being a womanizer and being kind of a schmuck. That's most of his parts. But Arnold did it for me. It's Arnold's month. He's hilarious in this movie. Like, there's just something about Arnold saying mundane lines, recognizing slang.
Yuckity yuck.
Wearing shorts on Hollywood Boulevard. It's delightful. His O face. Sweep it. It's a file.
We've agreed way too much. Way too much. We've agreed on every movie over the last six movies.
Well, to be fair, we weren't allowed to disagree with Amin last month.
Oh. Excellent point.
This is a real sweep. Is that what you guys are saying?
This is the first real sweep since Snake Eyes.
You'll notice if you look at the spreadsheet, we would have all agreed, Zach, if it weren't for Amin during Cage Month.
Yeah, because he was just like, I don't know what was wrong with him during that month. I think he was just gearing up for Black History Month.
What? What'd I do?
Hold on, Mayes. You phobed jujitsu, you dick.
Yeah, motherfucker.
It's not a movie.
Gone in 60 Seconds was terrible. Kiss of Death was terrible.
No, you're mad because you rented the wrong one. That's why you're mad.
But Kiss of Death?
Gone in 60 Seconds.
You shot yourself in the foot on that one.
Next time we make love, you introduce me to Jade.
Who's got next pick?
I do.
What you got?
Get to the chopper.
We've talked about this movie a lot. We've referenced it a lot. Can you believe we're going to do it? It's James Caan. It's Vanessa Williams. It's Arnold. It's Eraser.
Oh, the movie. Oh, wow. If you listen to this pod, you'll remember a tidbit of trivia I have about Eraser. I'm not going to say it. I'm going to save it for next time, for next week. It's the greatest trivia ever about Eraser. No one can ever beat it.
No, it's amazing.
Also, I never do this, but I'm going to guarantee it. We're going to have a special guest.
Ooh.
A guest that many of you love and appreciate.
Love. Yes.
And others may not know. For those who know this guest, you guys are going to love it.
And for those who don't, you're going to love it after.
Yo, Rob.
Yo, Amin.
What's the biggest complaint I always have whenever we record these podcasts?
Besides Jerv being too sleepy, I think it's you forget to name a couple things. You always want to talk about some extra stuff.
Oh, man. It's the worst feeling in the world. When we get done and we say cut and I'm sending the files to Rob and I say, shit, I forgot we were going to talk about this topic or that topic. Well, guess what? We're not going to have those problems anymore. If you go ahead and download the Stereo app. That's right. Go to stereo.com/Darth Amin and make sure you are linked and subscribe to us. And we're going to talk about all of the different things that I always forget about. This is a great app. Every time you guys are listening to this pod, you say, oh, I wish I could chime in. But you're listening to a pod. You can never chime in. It's pre-recorded. Guess what? With Stereo, you're able to have your voice heard. You can ask real-time questions about either the pod episode we recorded or whatever we're talking about at the time. It's great. It's a forum for you to listen to your favorite podcasters. That'll be me and yours truly, all at the Count the Things Network. And we're going to be out here. We're going to do this regularly, multiple times a week. Just hop on Stereo, download the app, subscribe, follow Darth Amin, follow Talk Hoops, follow Trayvon, follow Big Waz, all of us. You know who we are. You search for us on the Stereo app, you will find us and subscribe to us and be a part of these conversations real time. Have the ability to ask the questions that you want to ask. Stop us when we're on some bullshit, as we are frequently. And of course, catch some content that goes above and beyond what you listen to in the podcast you already love. Again, that is the Stereo app. And you can follow me, stereo.com/Darth Amin. You can look up everybody else by their handles. Their handles are all the same as what we have on social media. You join us multiple times a week. I love Stereo. I'm on the app talking all the time. Follow me and get notified every time I go live.